Hey everybody! Today, Rotto talks through Space Race the Card Game and its first expansion, Intercosmos, which is on Kickstarter right now. And you can learn more about it by hitting that I up in the top right corner screen to go check out the page. So, oh boy, folks, I did a run through for Space Race back when it was on Kickstarter. Was it last year, I think? And at the time, Jen and I were super duper impressed with just how solid this game was in prototype form. Finally got the final version. I'm just going to do a little bit of a tour through what the final game looks like so that you don't have to rely entirely on that prototype I showed you before. So let's open her up. You got a rule book, of course, and I got to say, a wonderful foam insert that keeps everything nice and divided really cool. And look how awesome this first player marker is. That's so awesome. Even has a little slot in there so you put its fin in and it is held firmly in place. Very, very nice. So the different space agencies, all the cards and ideas in the universe, really, really nice presentation. And I have to say, I am so ecstatic because you may recall when I did my run through for the prototype last year, I liked it a lot, but only had one complaint, which was the iconography that Jen and I had a very, very tough time grokking. I'm so happy they changed it. Actually, they pretty much did something very, very similar to kind of what I had suggested to them. And now it's easy peasy lemon squeezy to read these things. Basically, the format is always, cards. Where do they come from? Where do they go to? So this is saying the Voyager program, you can take two cards from the universe and add them to your lab. I mean, how simple is that? So much easier. Or from your lab to your agency. Super duper easy, very, very nicely done, makes the game so much more playable and really takes care of the only complaint we had about the original game. So, very, very happy. But now let's talk about what's new in the Intercosmos expansion. A bunch of stuff. First of all, the game can now go to 5 players because the Chinese space program with Taikonauts has been introduced. Now, the cards are pretty much the exact same, the same control cards you get for any. So the Chinese space program works like everybody else's. There's a few extra setup rules for changing how to set the game up to basically ensure that the universe is a little bit bigger and stuff like that, but pretty straightforward. I haven't tried it, of course, but it's still nice for players who are looking for a 5-player game. I would think it would still work just as well because, of course, the entire game is simultaneous action selection, right? So it's not like it's going to slow the game down to have a 5th player. So welcome, Taikonauts, to the space race. Next up, these are very cool. I like these a lot. Achievement cards. There are miscellaneous ones, agency ones, and card type ones. And what you do is every time you play as part of setup, you shuffle each of the decks up, and there's going to be 2 card types, 2 agencies randomly, and 1 miscellaneous. Boom. So these are all set up, and everybody can see them. And these are additional things you're trying to do. In addition to all the stuff you were already trying to pull off in the game in the original, now you are racing. This is still a race to be the first to have 2 or more propaganda cards, for example, in your agency. Or have a total of, this is another propaganda one. Have a total of propaganda strength of 4 more agency. So in this game, this would make this game a very propaganda heavy game, at least in the early game, because everybody is trying to get propaganda cards in play to achieve both of these. Because, like I said, it's a race. When somebody, this is interesting. So here I am as, this isn't Europe, this is the, a free market, the independent space agency. So this is me. If I've actually done what I need to do, I have, a total of, 1 total of 7 or higher in the agency. If I've done that, on the next time I'm going to do an action, because, players take turns. I do an action, you do an action, next player does an action, and so on and so on. Instead of doing an action on that turn, you could take one of the control cards you have not played yet and put it over here to mark that you have made that achievement or this achievement or this achievement. Use 2 abilities at the same stage in 1 round as an example. Or, let's just go for the propaganda. Hey, I have 2 propaganda cards. Yay, I was racing for it. I was the first one to do it. And so I mark this here. that's one less control card I have for the rest of the game. And of course, this whole game is about smartly using your control cards. What did I just give up? It's not random. I gave up my most powerful technology control card to do this. Now, maybe I'll give up my weakest one, but the weakest ones have the extra cool special powers and whatnot. So to claim these things, to get more points, you're giving up abilities you have for the rest of the game. But the interesting thing is, like I said, it's a race. If I've done it, and then shortly after me, the red player does it, you know, the Russian player does it. Well, I will score, I forget what it is. I think it's like, 5 points and then 3 points, or 4 points and then 2 points. I'd have to look at the rules again. But you want to get there first because you'll score more points. Second place scores fewer points. Third place scores even less. And then nobody else gets anything. There's a first, second, and third place for completing these objectives. And that becomes very, very interesting. And it makes the turn-based structure of resolving actions much more important. Because again, you're racing to achieve all these things, and every time you play, you're going to get a different combination of achievements that will make the game feel unique and strongly encourage players into certain paths. But knowing full well, you can't come in first on all of these. So which are the ones you're going to chase after? Which ones are your opponents going to chase after? So that is very, very cool. A fifth player is very, very cool. But probably most important, there are a ton of new space cards. The universe has become bigger and broader and wider. And I could go through all of them. Of course, these are, once again, all based on real world people and places and things and events and all that stuff. So it's all very awesome, with the same really great art, that is inspired by, the real famous pictures. Of course, mine's a prototype, so a lot of these are pictures. And, Jeff Bezos, I think, is going to be very, very happy to make it into the expansion. He was probably feeling a bit slighted to have not been in the original, but you're here, Jeff, you've made it. Taikonauts are joining, hooray. More famous cosmonauts and stuff like that. But anyway, so lots of cool new elements for all the space buffs out there. But more importantly, some new functions. Let's see. There's two main ones. This first one right here, Heavenly Palace, is a good example of one. You'll notice this says, hey, to activate this, take X cards from the universe and put in our lab. X is a new thing, and you look down here to see what X stands for in different cards. This one is equal to half the strength of your current control cards in play, because this is another huge game changer. These achievements already make players think more about what control cards they're playing, because in the original game, you chose control cards thinking mostly about what line do I want to activate and what new cards do I want to add to my agency. Those are your concerns. But now the concerns become more, because a lot of these cards are affected by what the strength of a control card that you're playing. Not just which control card, but whether you're playing that one, that three, or that six. Or in some cases, how many of you played up till now? Because some of these say, hey, how many of you played already? Or what's the total strength you've played so far? And then that becomes the X value. So those are a big deal. There's a lot of them. An LHC. X is equal to half of, that's kind of the same for, right. But anyway, so you get the basic idea. But there's another concept as well. The long march here, this one, you'll notice most of the time, the iconography is, hey, take two cards from your hand and put them in your lab. Or two cards from, the deck into your hand, or from your hand into your lab. Depending on how you activate this. But once you put this into your agency, in this case, immediately when you put this into your agency, you must. That's what the black card means. Normally it's a white card to say, hey, you can do this. It's a bonus. It's a benefit. It's a great thing you want to do. This is a requirement. If you put this into play, in addition to whatever control card you use to get this, you must now take a card from your hand and put it back into the deck. You put it at the bottom of the deck. You must do this. If not, then when you put the card in, the right half gets covered up, and all you get is the benefits of the left half, and you don't get the right. So this card has an extra cost to put into play right from the get-go. And the Mir space station. Of course, this is awesome. It's a lot like the Cape Canaveral and whatnot. Hey, it affects everything. This is a super powerful card once you get this into play. And they're not one time. It gets to use over and over and over again because they're on the left side of the card, unlike that stupid rules goof I made in my original run-through. But the important thing is, during the bureaucracy phase, you must take one card from your hand and put it back in the deck, or this card goes back to the universe and then somebody else gets it. So this, the Mir space station, has upkeep for the rest of the game. You're jettisoning cards from your hand to keep this thing functional. That is very, very cool. There's a lot of these cards that will give you some benefit, but to get the full benefit, you have to pay extra, you have to pay upkeep costs, et cetera, et cetera. Lots of very, very cool changes. Oh, yeah, actually, also, for players who like the interactive side thing, the original game just had two espionage cards. Now, there's two more of them. Cyber espionage you can have, where you look at the opponent's hand and take a card from their hand and put it into your agency. And then this goes into your lap. So, actually, it's interesting. I have to admit, Jen and I hate the espionage card from the original game. We actually just take it out and then randomly take two cards out of each of the other classes of cards just to avoid it and keep everything balanced. The cyber espionage, I don't mind so much because, of course, the cards in your hand, you haven't done anything with those yet. I mean, they're just potential. So, cyber espionage, actually, Jen and I are totally fine with. It's just, oh, well, what do you got right now? Well, that's kind of interesting. I'll take this and give the rest back. And then at the end of the round, when you're putting new cards out into the universe, if I can remember, I might have a better idea of what some of those cards might be. So cyber espionage, you know, for an attack card, this is our kind of attack card. It's pretty soft. That's pretty nice. But one more thing. So the breakthroughs. You will notice breakthroughs that have two icons on them, even some that have icons, again, depending on how many control cards you have played over the course of the game determines how many icons are on the breakthrough cards. So, a lot of very, very cool new changes to the core, not changes, additions to the core formula of Space Race, which is already a phenomenal little game. One other thing that's interesting and I probably should talk about is, let's get the box back here. I haven't done it yet. So this insert, which very nicely keeps all the cards, the original, you know, for each of the four player factions and the whatnot, if you look really close, you'll see there's cutouts. These teeth can be popped out, and this is a customizable, what do you call it? Divider. What you do is you pop a few of these out so that the universe space becomes twice as big, and then you have a section for the universe cards, a section for all the control cards in one section, and then all the achievement cards in one section. And so the entire expansion, which is a lot of new cards, will all fit into the original while still working with the divider as well. So Space Race the card game, phenomenal. I already told you that a year ago when I did the original run through, and they fixed my only complaint about it. This expansion, absolutely great as well. Oh, I forgot. One more cool thing coming in the expansion. Now, I don't have it. They just sent me a PDF of this, so I don't have the final. But in addition to all these cards you get with the expansion, the game is going to come with several historical scenarios that basically, for people who like Space Race but don't really like the kind of hodgepodge nature where, I think I talked about this in my original run-through, where Buzz Aldrin could be a Russian cosmonaut who was funded by Richard Branson, you know, because you just get this crazy mishmash of things, and he landed on Venus, you know, whatever. You could get those weird, you know, jigsaw puzzle, put everything together. Now the expansion will introduce historical scenarios that have you set up the game in specific ways, thematic ways, so that real historical contests will make a lot more sense. You put specific cards into the deck instead of just everything. Players get specific control card setups, and there are certain additional rules that say, hey, in the early ages, there was no propaganda yet, so you don't start doing propaganda till halfway through the game, because in the early days, it was all into, you know. So, I think that's very, very cool as well. They sent me one, we played with it, which is a Russia versus America in the early days, and there were a few simple changes to the rules that made it feel very, very different. So this expansion makes an already fantastic game even better. And that's it, folks. That is Space Race the Card Game and Intercosmos. Like I said right up front, it's on Kickstarter right now. You can hit that I or go follow the show notes. People who missed out on the original game, definitely check it out, because the Kickstarter page says something about how the last 1,000 copies of this game are available through this campaign. I don't know if that means it'll never be available again in retail. I genuinely don't know. I've got my copy, so I'm just not too terribly worried about it, but all I can say is, real world space fans or fans of really cool card combo engine building games, this is something really phenomenal to seek out. And that's it, folks. That is Space Race the Card Game and the Intercosmos expansion. Thanks for watching. Have a very, very nice day. Talk to you later. So long. Bye-bye.